Ladies and gentlemen, may I please ask you now to take your seats. Before we move into the proceedings, please join me in thanking Mr. Isaac Hannam for this wonderful Yeriki performance of His Excellency, the Governor arrived. Isaac is a proud Kaurna and Wurundjeri man who, through continual learning and practice, integrates culture through his everyday life and is passionate about preserving and celebrating his people and culture. Ninamani, ladies and gentlemen, I would now like to officially welcome you all to South Australia's Parliament House on the occasion of this special sitting in Parliament to witness the passage of the First Nations Voice Bill 2023. The bill, which has just passed through both houses, poses a connected, direct and independent line of communicating for First Nations people in South Australia to Parliament. It will provide certainty for First Nations people to have the ability to have their say and to engage with government and policies and services that impact on First Nations communities. I would like to officially acknowledge our ancestors and old people who walked before us. We know they are here with us today. I would like to extend a particular welcome to Her Excellency, the Honourable Frances Adamson, AC, Governor of South Australia, and Mr. Bunton, the Honourable Peter Malinauskas, Premier of South Australia. The Honourable Chief Justice Chris Koukas, Chief Justice of South Australia. Members of the South Australian Cabinet, the Honourable Dr. Susan Close, the Honourable Kyron Maher, the Honourable Tom Koutas-Antonis, the Honourable Stephen Mulligan, the Honourable Zoe Bedison, the Honourable Chris Picton, the Honourable Katrine Hilliard, the Honourable Nat Cook, the Honourable Claire Scriven, the Honourable Blair Boyner, the Honourable Jeff Brock, the Honourable Andrea Michaels, the Honourable Joe Sockarch, the Honourable Nick Champion, President of the Legislative Council, the Honourable Terry Stevens, and the Speaker of the House of Assembly, the Honourable Dan Cregan, Federal Minister, the Honourable Amanda Rishworth, the Honourable David Spears, Leader of the Opposition, former Governors of South Australia, Rear Admiral, the Honourable Kevin Skess, the Honourable Sir Eric Neill, members of the Legislative Council and members of the House of Assembly, Federal Members of Parliament, Judicial Representatives, Senior Defence Force Representatives, Commissioner for First Nations Voice, Mr. Dale Ages, Government and Community Leaders, ladies and gentlemen. Please, a big round of applause for our special guests, including yourself. On this historic occasion, we have witnessed the passage of the First Nations Voice Bill 2023 through the South Australian Parliament. In order to become law, however, Her Excellency, the Honourable Frances Adamson, Governor of South Australia, following advice and consent of Executive Council, must first give royal assent to the bill. At this time, I would like to invite the President of the Legislative Council, the Honourable Terry Stevens, together with Mr. Dale Ages, Commissioner for the First Nations Voice, to present the Royal Arms Print for the First Nations Voice Bill 2023 to Her Excellency, the Honourable Frances Adamson, AC, Governor of South Australia. Thank you, Commissioner. I would now like to invite Her Excellency, the Premier, the Deputy Premier, and the Minister for Aboriginal Affairs to take their place at the table as they convene at the meeting of the Executive Council, the formal executive arm of government. I would also like to invite First Nations representatives seated on the stage to now position themselves so as to witness the meeting's proceedings.
Premier, Deputy Premier, Attorney General, good morning.
Good morning.
Over to you, Premier.
Thank you, Your Excellency. The Council recommends, Your Excellency, assent to the First Nations Voice Bill 2023, an act to give First Nations people a voice that will be heard by the Parliament of South Australia, the Government of South Australia, and other persons and bodies, to establish local First Nation voices and the state First Nations voice, to repeal the Aboriginal Lands Parliamentary Standing Committee Act 2003, to amend the Constitution Act 1934, and for other purposes.
Thank you. Sorry. Yeah.
Gana Borgana Aelia, Yaichim Borgana Aelia, Yaichimina Aelia, Gana Borgana Aelia, Kumatana Yartananku, Nyatu na Tampandi, Gana Miena, Yaichi Adamatana, Bukinanku, Yalaka, Takaricha. Dearest Gana elders and Gana people, dearest Aboriginal elders and Aboriginal people from other lands and regions, I acknowledge and pay my respects to you all. I also acknowledge that we are meeting today on the traditional lands of the Kaurna people, from the past, today, and into the future. Premier, Deputy Premier, Attorney General, President, Speaker, Leader of the Opposition, Commissioner for First Nations Voice, First Nations representatives, and other distinguished guests, friends, all. It is my pleasure as South Australia's 36th Governor to give assent to the First Nations Voice Bill 2023. Executive Council, the process by which government ministers present bills for my assent is normally private, but today, for the very best of reasons, took place in front of you all. Nearly 200 years ago, good intentions towards Aboriginal people proclaimed by our first governor were encompassed in the foundational documents of our state. History shows, regrettably, that they did not come to fruition. Today, I restate my commitment to supporting the process of reconciliation in our state, and to working side by side with Aboriginal people and non-Aboriginal people to achieve this goal. Thank you, everyone, for your presence today to witness this historic occasion.
Thank you, Your Excellency. Your Excellency, Premier, Deputy Premier, Minister for Aboriginal Affairs, First Nations representatives, I now invite you to return to your seats. I would now like to invite I would now like to invite the Premier of South Australia, the Honourable Peter Malinauskas, to the lectern.
Your Excellency, parliamentary colleagues, people of South Australia, we stand here with our feet firmly on the lands of the Kaurna people. I pay my respect to their elders past, present and emerging, but the way we pay our respects first and foremost is not with our words, but in our deeds. And there are no more powerful deeds than South Australia becoming the first place in our nation to pass a law enshrining an Indigenous voice to our Parliament.
South Australia has always been capable of doing important things at important moments. And today, again, our state assumes a position of leadership in advancing, via democratic means, the cause of all people. All people. The voice to our Parliament isn't just about Indigenous South Australians. It's about each and every one of us who are so fortunate to call this amazing patch of land our home. But for those of us who are not Indigenous, this land has never been always our home. By definition, for all non-Indigenous Australians, we are each a product of our own migrant story. One of the most beautiful things about modern Australia, in particular civil society in South Australia, is that we've always opened our hearts to those who have come from across the seas. We are rightly proud of the way that we have welcomed waves of migration from all over the world. And every day, we enjoy the benefits of living with and learning from the diverse perspectives that other cultures provide. People choose to come here because they know they're coming to a place better than the one they left. The peace, the potential, the prosperity. And prosper they do. Families almost universally passing on a better standard of living from one generation to the next. It's a remarkable Australian story, the unrivaled potential that this country has afforded all of us. Almost all of us. Because it's an even more remarkable Australian tragedy that the one group of people that have been left most behind for the last 200 years are the very people who for over 65,000 years have provided great care and custodianship to the land we stand on today. For as long as Aboriginal Australia is excluded from sharing in our nation's prosperity, we carry an injustice that weighs upon us all. We're all familiar with the statistics, the reduced life expectancy, the disproportionate rates of poverty, the lack of access to so many of life's necessities. Stats that come together every year in the heartbreaking Closing the Gap report. But all of us, at some point, have witnessed this tragedy firsthand. I will never forget the time I had the opportunity to visit the Port Augusta prison. And I was struck visibly by the overrepresentation of Aboriginal people in custody. It felt like every single second prisoner I met was Indigenous. And I was being shown around, and I remember chatting to one older gentleman who was sharing me his life story. And his adult life story was defined by imprisonment. It was his 11th occasion that he was back in prison. And then we went around the corner, and I was introduced to a young gentleman. It would have been in his early 20s at most. And he explained to me that this was the second time that he was in prison. That conversation concluded, and we walked away, and the prison officer said to me, "You know that young fella? He was the son of the older fella." I don't know anyone in South Australia who doesn't believe that we should at least try and do a lot better than this. Although this tragedy of Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander disadvantage cannot be laid at the feet of any of us as individuals. We must all collectively accept our responsibility to find a path of reconciliation and remediation. A path that, despite moments of great effort and goodwill, we have so far been unable to truly find as a nation. But in May 2017, despite the history of dispossession, displacement and despair, our First Nations people came from across the continent together to consolidate all of their hopes, their aspirations, into one single document, the Uluru Statement from the Heart. And within the Uluru Statement, the Australian people were given a new path. We can't say how long this path is or when we'll arrive at the destination. But it's a path that Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander people have invited us to walk with them on. Today, in South Australia, we have accepted that invitation. Who knows how we might benefit from drawing on 65,000 years of wisdom? I firmly believe that there are more than a few things that this Parliament can learn from the longest living continuous culture that the world has ever seen. But the voice isn't just for prime ministers, premiers, and politicians. It's a call out to all of us. And we shouldn't expect that it will all be easy, or that we'll like everything that we hear, or that the Parliament will agree with everything the voice has to say. But this is nothing to fear, for diversity of opinion is democracy at its best. In the modern era, too often we gravitate to the opinions that we already agree with. But that's never how the best decisions are made. Any enduring policy or purpose invariably benefits from the perspectives of others. So we will embrace the opportunity the voice gives us to infuse our Parliament, our democracy, with the knowledge and experience of our First Nations, particularly on matters that pertain to their future, which is indivisible from our own. In 1894, when we became the first jurisdiction in the world to give women the right to vote and run for Parliament, the nation looked to South Australia's example on how to advance the democratic project. Today, with the eyes of the nation upon our state, we become the first to make this important change. A change that ensures that our democracy is yet another step closer to achieving the eternal Australian aspiration of a fair go for all. Including those who have lived here the longest, the traditional owners of the land. For from today, in this state, their voices will be heard.
Thank you, Premier. I think he deserves another round of applause for the Premier, please. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming Adelaide-based singer-songwriter and proud Anambana and Yarrawa man, Mr. Nathan May, to the stage. Nathan grew up in Darwin, but has ancestral connections in South Australia and has called Adelaide home for the past several years. Among his accomplishments in 2019, Nathan was named Young Aboriginal Artist of the Year, and in 2022 was also presented with the Creative Young Achievers Award for his contribution and outstanding achievements in music. Ladies and gentlemen, with the performance of From Little Things, Big Things Grow, Mr. Nathan May.
I think a lot of you know this song. Gather around people, tell you a story. An ancient old story of power and pride, of British love vesting and Vincent Lignari. We're ups and men on opposite sides. Old Vesty was fast with money and muscle. Beef was his business and broad was his door. Vincent was lean but spoke very little. He had no bank balance, hard dirt was his flow. From little things, big things grow. From little things, big things grow. Gurindji were working for nothing but rations, where they once gathered the wealth and the land. Daily depression got tighter and tighter. Gurindji decided they must make a stand. They picked up their swags and started off walking at Wadi Creek, where they sat themselves down. But now it don't sound much, but it sure got tongues talking back in the homestead. And then in the town we all sing. From little things, big things grow. From little things, big things grow. Old Vestyman said, I'll double your wages, 18 quid a week you have in your hand. Vincent said, nah, we're not talking about wages. We're standing right here till we get our land. Vesty man roar and vesty man thunder. You don't stand a chance in the cinder snow. Vincent said, if we fall, others be rising. Saying, from little things, big things grow. From little things, big things grow. And Vincent Lignari boarded an airplane, landed in Sydney, big city of lights. And Vincent sat down with big politicians.
This is going too fast, so I'm going to go back to the chorus.
From little things, big things grow. From,
sing along,
things, big things grow. While it slows down. From little things, big things grow. From little things, big things grow. Vincent Lignari returning an airplane back to his country. Sit down with his people.
This thing's stuffing up.
And he told his people, let the stars keep on turning. We have friends in the south, in the cities and towns. 8 years went by, 8 long years of waiting, to one day a tall stranger appeared in the land. He came with his lawyers, and he came with great ceremony, and threw Vincent's fingers, poured a handful of sand. From little things, big things grow. From little things, big things grow. Oh,
this is the story of Vincent Lignari. But this is a story of something much more. How power and privilege cannot move a people who know where they stand and stand with the law. We all sing from little things, big things grow. 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 From little things, big things grow.
Thank you, Nathan. Absolutely beautiful. Thank you. I'd also like to take this opportunity to thank our Auslan interpreters, Miss Heather Lode and Miss Emma Cresdy. Ladies and gentlemen, it is now my privilege to now invite South Australia's Minister for Aboriginal Affairs and First Aboriginal Attorney General, the Honourable Kaya Mark, to the lectern.
Where we are today,
thanks, honey.
On Kaurna land, like the whole of this state, like the whole of this nation, always has been, always will be Aboriginal country. Today, our state has achieved something extraordinary. In the building behind me, and those who've occupied it, have not always done right by Aboriginal people. In fact, for so much of our history, it's been the opposite. Governments formed in this building have been complicit in the massacres of Aboriginal people, complicit in the taking of land, complicit in trying to erase identity and belonging, complicit in the removal of Aboriginal children from their families and from their culture for no other reason than being Aboriginal. Complicit in prolonging and normalising the disadvantage of Aboriginal communities and Aboriginal people by failing year upon year, decade upon decade, and government after government, failing to take meaningful action to reverse it. One of the reasons these atrocities were able to occur was because of what the Uluru Statement describes as the torment of our powerlessness. We all know what powerlessness looks like for the oldest Australians, the First Nation peoples of this continent, a lack of services, a lack of recognition, a lack of respect, and a lack of opportunity. Opportunity to speak and be heard. For too long, Aboriginal people have lacked a meaningful voice in the decision-making that fundamentally affects our lives. In decades and centuries gone by, the laws of our state and the colony that preceded it have done so much to deliberately disenfranchise, disempower, and disadvantage Aboriginal people. Today, we use those laws to do exactly the opposite. South Australia now leads the nation by legislating for a First Nations voice. A voice that's empowered to speak to the parliament, to speak to the ministers, to speak to the government departments, to speak directly to the decision makers who've so often struggled to make meaningful change. A voice that will help decision makers create enduring positive change for the future. Friends, today isn't the end of a journey, it's the beginning. Enshrining a voice to Parliament in law is the first step in our commitment to the full implementation of the Uluru Statement from the Heart. The Uluru Statement calls for three core elements: voice, truth, treaty, and we'll deliver on all three. And the voice to Parliament will be heard loud and clear in shaping the approach to the tasks ahead, agreement making and truth telling. Today, we've lit a beacon of hope for the rest of the nation. The referendum that will be held later this year will seek to elevate the voice of Aboriginal people right across the country. I commit myself to doing all I can in the lead up to the referendum, and I know that so many of you here will as well. No change of this magnitude is easy. The campaign ahead of us will not be easy. Parts of it already have and will continue to be painful and difficult for many Aboriginal people. But because something's hard doesn't mean it's not worth doing. So often it's the opposite. And it's made easier when we do it together. Everybody who's come here today to show support for our voice to Parliament is playing their part in making sure our beacon of hope shines brighter. What we've done today will change this state for the better, and I believe what we've done today has the potential to change Australia, because the nation will watch us reshape the way Aboriginal and non-Aboriginal South Australians work together towards common goals. The nation will watch us ensuring that decision-making no longer ignores but invites First Nations people. And the nation will watch us work to embed respect for the First Peoples, not only in the processes of government, but the everyday thinking of our community. South Australia can show the nation that we have nothing to fear and everything to gain. The choosing to walk together will not diminish any single one of us, but will elevate us all. I am truly humbled by the patience, the dignity, and the generosity of so many First Nations South Australians who, despite waiting so long for this moment to arrive, are still so ready to help make it matter. It's not every day that we get to do something that has the potential to influence the course of a nation's history. But friends, we do that today. Thank you.
Thank you, Minister. And another round of applause, please. Ladies and gentlemen, on this historic occasion, it gives me great pleasure to now invite Narunga woman, Ms. Cheryl Axelby, to read the Uluru Statement from the Heart.
Wow. Thank you, everyone, for getting up, standing up and showing up today. It's a proud moment for South Australia, and I'm glad that we are leading the nation in going forward. I'd like to acknowledge that we are standing on the lands of the Kaurna peoples, and I pay my respect to Kaurna elders, past, present and emerging, and to all our mob all over South Australia. Today is quite a significant day. Yeah. And before I read the Uluru Statement of the Heart, I know that we have people who have their own opinions and the democratic voice, but I think today you demonstrated that we in South Australia are in support of the voice, and by looking at the number of protesters here today, we far outweigh them, so thank you. So today, we gathered at the 2017 National Constitutional Convention, coming from all points of the southern sky, make this statement from the heart. Our Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander tribes were the first sovereign nations of the Australian continent and its adjacent lands, and possessed it under our own laws and customs. This our ancestors did according to the reckoning of our culture from the creation, according to the common law from time immemorial, and according to the science of more than 60,000 years ago. This sovereignty is a spiritual notion, the ancestral tie between the land or Mother Nature and the Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander peoples who were born therefrom, remain attached thereto, and must one day return thitherto, be reunited with our ancestors. This link is the basis of the ownership of the soil, or better, of sovereignty. It has never been ceded or extinguished and coexists with the sovereignty of the Crown. How could it be otherwise that peoples possessed a land for 60 millennia and the sacred link disappears from world history in merely the last 200 years? With substantive constitutional change and structural reform, we believe this ancient sovereignty can shine through as a fuller expression of Australia's nationhood. Proportionately, we are the most incarcerated people on the planet. We are not an innately criminal people. Our children are alienated from their families at unprecedented rates. This cannot be because we have no love for them. And our youth languish in detention in obscene numbers. They should be our hope for the future. These dimensions of our crisis tell plainly the structural nature of our problem. This is the torment of our powerlessness. We seek constitutional reforms to empower our people and take a rightful place in our own country. When we have power over our destiny, our children will flourish. They will walk in two worlds, and their culture will be a gift to their country. We call for the establishment of a First Nations voice enshrined in the Constitution. Makarrata is the culmination of our agenda and coming together after a struggle. It captures our aspirations for a fair and truthful relationship with the people of Australia and a better future for our children based on justice and self-determination. We seek a Makarrata Commission to supervise a process of agreement making between governments and First Nations and truth-telling about our history. In 1967, we were counted. In 2017, we seek to be heard. We leave base camp and start our trek across this vast country. We invite you to walk with us in a movement of the Australian people for a better future. Thank you.
Thank you, Cheryl. So beautiful to hear those words. Ladies and gentlemen, this concludes the formalities of today's special sitting of Parliament. I would like to thank you all for attending this historic occasion. However, there is still much to celebrate on this significant day in the history of our state. To help us is one final performer, Ms. Tilly Jala Thomas. Tilly is a Nukunu singer-songwriter who grew up on the Fleurieu Peninsula south of Adelaide. Since finishing school in 2020, Tilly has received numerous industry accolades, including Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander Musician of the Year, Nimma unearthed award of the 2021 National Indigenous Music Awards and the Emily Burrows Award of the 2021 South Australian Music Award. This year, Tilly was awarded the Stigwood Artist Fellowship and released her second EP, Sanctuary. As I invite Tilly onto the stage, I invite all our official guests to move off the stage. So ladies and gentlemen, thank you, thank you, thank you, and please enjoy.
Thank you. The color of the skin is your pride. enjoy. Black boy, black boy, your life is not destroyed. Ah, 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 ah. He didn't know the school, but they called him Black Boy. He hardly talked to girls and boys. Don't be a fool, just obey the rules. Then you'll learn the truth. Black boy, black boy, the color of your skin is your pride and joy. Sticks.